morning from slow-moving LA traffic. PvP is here. It's a crazy time in Pokemon Go. And I have some important meetings this morning. So, we're talking in the car, as we often do. Maybe not that often. Once in a while. Right now, I want to start off by talking about the most important things you need to know for PvP, the biggest changes that came with the PvP update, because there are a few to be aware of before you start really getting invested in the new PvP system. First of all, the biggest change, probably, is the addition of the second charge move. Pokemon can now unlock a second charge move for a Stardust and Candy cost, and that cost varies by species of Pokemon. So, the costs more or less align with buddy distance, so a Pokemon that has a 1 kilometer buddy distance will cost 10,000 Stardust and 25 Candy to unlock a move. A Pokemon with a 3 kilometer buddy distance will cost 50,000 Stardust and 50 Candy to unlock a second charge move. And a Pokemon with a 5 kilometer buddy distance, the pseudo legendaries for the most part, will cost 75,000 Stardust and 75 buddy candies. Legendary and mythical Pokemon with a 20 kilometer buddy distance are gonna cost 100,000 Stardust and 100 candies. That's a very steep price to pay. And again, that's part of the reason why I continue to say, wait until the dust settles before you start investing heavily into Pokemon. The exceptions to those rules are baby Pokemon and starter Pokemon. Starter Pokemon have a cost of 10,000 Stardust and 25 candies, the same cost as 1 kilometer buddy Pokemon. So any starter Pokemon costs 10,000 dust, 25 candies. Baby Pokemon have the same cost, 10,000 dust and 25 candies, but only while they're baby Pokemon. Baby Pokemon are the only Pokemon whose costs will change as they evolve. Every other Pokemon remains the same throughout all of its evolutions. So Pidgey, Pidgeotto, and Pidgeot will all have the same cost to unlock a new move. Charmander, Charmeleon, Charizard, all the same cost. Any Pokemon throughout its evolutions will have the same cost except for baby Pokemon. Baby Pokemon cost 10,000 Stardust as babies, and then their cost increases to 50,000 Stardust after they've evolved, or whatever their appropriate Stardust cost would be based on their buddy distance. Once a Pokemon has a second charge move unlocked, it will keep that charge move, no matter what. It's never gonna lose it. It won't lose it if it evolves, it won't lose it if you trade it. It's always gonna have that second charge move. And when that Pokemon does evolve, it's gonna reroll both of its charge moves. So the same way that you get new moves when you evolve now, if you have two moves, you're gonna get two new moves. And then finally, there is no reduced cost for lucky Pokemon. So a lucky Pokemon is gonna cost the same amount of Stardust and Candy to unlock its charge move as a non-lucky Pokemon would. Get the sun in your eyes. Sorry about that. One last thing is that you can choose which move to change when you use a Charge TM. So when you use a Charge TM on a Pokemon with two moves, it's going to give you the option of which move you want to reroll. So be careful with that, especially if you're using that TM on a Pokemon who has a Legacy move, a Community Day move. Make sure you're choosing the right move when you use that TM. I think that about covers second charge moves. That's everything you need to know, everything we know right now. The next most important thing is that there are changes to the actual damage formula and changes to damage modifiers in Pokemon Go. So type effectiveness has been buffed. The amount of damage that a Pokemon deals for using a super effective attack has been increased from 1.4 to 1.6. Super effective is now more effective. In the main series games, it's still a x2 modifier, so we're not quite at main series levels yet, but it has increased. 1.6 is your damage multiplier for super effective moves. On the flip side, not very effective moves have also been buffed or debuffed. The modifiers have changed for that as well. For not very effective moves, the modifier has changed from 0.714 down to 0.625. This is significant because 0.625 times 1.6 evens out to 1. So if a Pokemon has a weakness on one of its types and a resistance on its other type, it's finally going to neutralize to neutral damage, 100% regular damage. Previously, that didn't work out exactly to 1, which is why when you used a move against a Pokemon in the previous or gym or raid battle system, if the Pokemon had one resistance and one weakness, it would still show up as a not very effective move. That should be fixed in the PvP system. And then additionally, we do have one more modifier for immunities. In the main series, immunities are Pokemon types that take zero damage from certain types of attacks. So ground is immune to electric, steel is immune to poison, dark is immune to psychic. Might as well just list them all, right? Ghost is immune to fighting and normal. Normal is immune to ghost. I think that's all of them. Is that all of them? Someone comment if I missed one. In Pokemon Go, we have immunities, but they're not completely immune. The modifiers are just more significant than not very effective damage. Our modifiers now have changed from 0.51 down to 0.39. So if a Pokemon is immune to a type of move, it's gonna take 40% or 39% of the actual damage, the neutral damage that that move would deal. So again, 1.6 is the modifier for super effective moves. Compare that to stab, same type attack bonus, which is 1.2. So in most cases now, it's better to use a super effective move to go for the actual super effective move than it is to use a neutral same type move as the Pokemon who's attacking. Same type attack bonus, remember, is a bonus that's applied if the move you're using is the same type as the Pokemon who's using it. Super effective is much better than stab bonus is now in the PvP battle system. And now that I've completely stopped here on the freeway, speaking of moves and effectiveness, every single move has new stats for PvP. Every move has new stats. Stats for moves work differently in PvP than they do in the gym or raid battle systems, and these new PvP move stats don't show up in game, don't correlate directly with the stats that you see in game. We're used to moves having charge bars. Each charge move requires a certain number of energy, the total energy being 100, so a 1-bar charge move, 100 energy, a 2-bar charge move would cost 50 energy, and a 3-bar charge move would cost 33.33 energy. That's all changed. In the PvP battle system, moves do not directly correlate with the number of charge bars that they display. Some of them are close, some of them are not as close. Each move has its own individual energy value. These values range from about 30, maybe 35 energy is the lowest, all the way up to around 80 for the strongest or the highest energy cost moves. Now, I'm gonna go over all of these changes to moves in detail in the next video, but for now, I've linked to a spreadsheet from a Redditor whose name I unfortunately can't look up because I'm driving right now, but it's there on screen, that extracted all of this new move data from the game master file. So you can go check out which moves have the highest or lowest energy costs. It also lists the damage per energy or the damage of the moves. And then additionally, fast moves have also changed in that every single fast move has the same speed now. Even though this is not a turn-based system, moves are now approached as turns. Every fast move, I'm outside of a Starbucks. I'm editing inside right now, so let's make this quick. I need to correct something I said here. Every move now takes a certain number of turns. A turn is half a second. Each fast move takes between 1 and 5 turns, which means the duration of each fast move is between half a second and 2.5 seconds. Again, these moves charge energy at different rates than we're used to, and there's a spreadsheet linked in the description that shows you all of that data. So fast moves are different, charge moves are different. So we can't look at the old rankings of moves that we used for the raid and battle systems. We have brand new stats, brand new rankings for moves for the PvP battle system. And again, we're gonna go into detail on that in the next video. Detailed PvP strats coming soon. Finally, I wanna talk about rewards because we all want them. Yes, you can get Sinnoh Stones from PvP. And you can actually, many people have reported, get 2 Sinnoh Stones or multiple Sinnoh Stones from winning one battle. I have terrible luck and didn't get a single Sinnoh Stone out of any of my 4 battles that counted. Remember, you can earn rewards one time from battling a team leader, an NPC, and those are available by looking at your nearby list. Down in the corner, you open your nearby list where it shows nearby Pokemon and raids. You also now have a battle tab where you can initiate a battle by showing a player your QR code, or you can battle one of the team leaders, the NPCs. Those will give you rewards once per day for a chance at a Sinnoh Stone or Stardust, and you can earn rewards 3 times per day from battling actual trainers. You can battle the same trainer 3 times and earn rewards, but only 3 actual trainer battles per day will give you a shot at rewards. I did do some battles after midnight and got 2 Sinnoh Stones out of it, so yay me, I guess. Stardust rewards right now appear to be sort of random, but let's be real, 500 Stardust is nothing compared to a Sinnoh Stone. We all want the stones. And a very, very important note on rewards is that you're not going to get rewards if your bag is full. So make sure you have space in your bag before initiating a battle, because if your bag is full, no rewards, and there's no way to go back and get them later on. Make sure your bag has space in it before you battle. Remember, you can battle Ultra and Best Friends remotely. You can do that by going to your actual friend's page, and alongside the trade button, there's now a battle button. You can issue a challenge at any time. You can also turn off challenges if people are challenging you way too often. And then you can also challenge nearby trainers. You don't even have to be friends to battle nearby trainers. You just have to show or scan someone's QR code. You can start a battle with them right away. What else do we know about the PvP system right now? You can choose multiple Pokemon of the same species, so you could bring in multiple Charizard or multiple Raichu or whatever. Doesn't seem like there's a limit on that. Of course, we knew this already, but Ditto and Shedinja are both banned from PvP. Ditto, obviously, because PvP leagues are based on CP. If a Ditto transforms, its CP is going to change, and you could potentially go over the CP limit for the league. So instead of coming up with a different way to address that, Niantic has banned Ditto outright from PvP. Again, as far as leagues go, right now it seems like there's no difference in rewards. You can earn the same rewards no matter what league you're playing in. And as for leagues, I mean, I said it before, but Great and Ultra is where it's at. Way more diversity, especially in Great League. And much less cost prohibitive. Don't have to max Pokemon out to play in Great League. So I think that's where we're going to be hanging out. In the meantime, we have more traffic ahead, but we'll pick this up soon. Okay, wait, you didn't think it was going to be so soon, did you? As for actual in-battle mechanics, you get 2 Protect Shields per battle. You're limited to 2 Shields, so use them wisely. There is a 50-second cooldown on switching Pokemon. Again, use that switch wisely. And very important to know with switching is that you can continue to take damage while you're switching. Switching does not stop damage from incoming. So if your opponent is switching Pokemon, keep attacking. If you are switching Pokemon, be aware, your Pokemon is going to continue taking damage as it switches in.